Welcome to this expert mini module on diagnostic assessment in reading. In Project Expert, we are developing and testing a program to support teacher expertise in data-based instruction and improve outcomes for upper elementary students with persistent reading challenges. We have three guiding questions for this module. Throughout this module, we will think through content related to diagnostic assessments, such as why we use them, when to use them, and different types of these data. Recall the Data-Based Individualization, DBI, process. As we provide supplemental intervention for students, we collect and graph progress monitoring data frequently, and often weekly. After providing intervention, and then collecting and graphing progress monitoring data, we may observe that the student is not adequately responding to the intervention or instruction. The next step is to collect diagnostic data to better understand why the student may not be responding. By this point, we've already collected multiple points of progress monitoring data. However, this only tells us that there is a problem. It does not diagnose exactly what the problem is. Therefore, progress monitoring, CBM, data does not alone give us the information we need to know to adjust our instruction and intervention. Our goal with diagnostic assessments is to identify specific aspects of the instruction or environment that we can adjust to better meet the student's needs. See our mini module on CBM graphs for more information on determining student response from CBM data. Remember, oral reading fluency is not an isolated skill. Although we may have data about a student's reading fluency, this data represents their overall reading achievement, their ability in multiple skill areas. Accuracy and automaticity are integral to fluent reading, which also requires some level of comprehension and language processes as well. Again, CBM data can alert us that a change is needed. Diagnostic assessments can provide more specific information about these aforementioned subskills so we know what skills to target for a particular student. Diagnostic assessments help identify specific skills to target or aspects of the instruction or environment to change. These assessments are used on an as-needed basis, primarily with at-risk students. Educators may use diagnostic assessment data to diagnose why current instruction is not meeting their needs, identify specific skills and abilities to target, plan individualized intensive interventions for struggling students. Diagnostic assessments give us diagnostic data. To clarify the terms we'll use in this module, diagnostic assessments, the process, give us diagnostic data, the information we can use. Let's take a moment to reflect on diagnostic assessments. If you need a bit more time, pause the video to think about these questions. Reflection. Imagine you're working with a young student named Tito. His progress monitoring shows inconsistent growth. His ORF accuracy tends to range from 60 to 80%. During your sessions, you sometimes catch Tito staring off into space or waiting for his peers to respond before echoing their responses. What other information are you curious about? What information would help you better meet Tito's needs? What information were you curious about? At this stage, there could be a number of hypotheses for next steps. Some ideas we considered are, his accuracy is below what we expect. What do his errors look like? How often is he off task? How often is he engaged? Is he accessing our instruction? If we see a need for diagnostic data, there are a number of sources to gather from. Diagnostic data can enrich our understanding of a student's skills, the instruction we're providing, the roles of student behavior, and their environment. Let's first discuss skills data. There are many different informal diagnostic assessments that can give us valuable information for identifying gaps in students' reading skills. Since most common difficulties with reading are in the area of word reading, you may choose to use an oral reading fluency, ORF error analysis, a spelling error analysis, and/or a phonics inventory. In the next few slides, we will briefly address each option. If you've been using ORF for progress monitoring and keeping notes on the errors students make, you can use these for an ORF error analysis. To do an ORF error analysis, take careful notes during ORF probes. For each student error, record information such as the actual word, the word the student said, and the characteristics of the missed word. For example, is the word a sight word? Did the student miss the beginning sound? Is it a word with a short vowel? Etc. Another option for an informal diagnostic assessment is a spelling error analysis. Spelling and word reading share many sub-skills in common. For example, phonemic awareness, phonics skills, and morphemic awareness are integral to both spelling and word reading. Therefore, assessing spelling errors can reveal a lot about reading skills. On the left of each cell is an example error in that category with the correct spelling on the right. For example, in the second row at the top, a student spelling hate, like H-A-I-T, may be unfamiliar with V-C-E patterns. An advantage of administering spelling error analyses is that unlike ORF error analysis, a teacher can administer spelling error analyses to a group of children at one time. The final type of informal diagnostic assessment we will discuss is a phonics inventory. As this example shows, the student reads real words that follow a pattern, long vowels or R-controlled vowels, for example, followed by nonsense words following that same pattern. The teacher marks errors, recording the student's response for each mispronounced word. As with the other error analyses we have discussed, the phonics inventory will give the teacher information about what particular skills to target for that student. There are plenty of existing sources of academic data you can explore too. If a student qualifies for special education or was evaluated in the past, you can draw upon their psychoeducational evaluation to learn more about their academic skills. Keep in mind whether these data are recent or not. You can also connect with your student's general education teacher to see if they have materials that would help you understand the student's current skills. Let's do a quick check with true or false. Reading fluency is useful because we can assess it efficiently and it tells us about multiple interrelated skills. This is true. The key idea for this module is that reading fluency indicates multiple skills, but we bring in other data to better understand specific skills. CBM data are helpful for understanding why a student is not responding to instruction. This is false. CBM data are helpful in knowing when a student is responding to instruction, but we need more information to make an informed theory as to why. Recall that four possible areas of diagnostic information are skills, instructional, behavioral, and environmental. We've looked at how various assessments can give us information about a student's specific skills. Now let's look at how we, as teachers, provide other sources of information. Diagnostic data can enrich our understanding of a student's skills, the instruction we're providing, the roles of student behavior, and their environment. Another dimension to consider is the quality of the instruction we're providing. First, you might consider your delivery, which includes the language you use and how you present the material. You might also consider the dosage or strength of your instruction. Students who are engaged and provided ample opportunities to practice with and demonstrate the material are getting a stronger dose of the intervention. Maintaining a brisk pace with little dead time means your instruction is more concentrated for the time you have. Relatedly, strong instruction involves immediately, but positively and specifically, providing feedback to a student who makes an error. The more we can help the student immediately understand the correct response and practice it themselves, the more they will be able to learn and internalize. Lastly, we can also consider how our instruction matches the way it should be delivered. For more information on the various components of instruction, check out our mini module on instructional adjustments. Measuring any or all of the components on the previous slide can be an undertaking on their own. One of the easiest ways to better understand our instruction is to have a peer or coach observe us and provide feedback. How often did we provide opportunities to respond? How did we or could we minimize dead time during the session? Alternatively, you could monitor yourself, formally or informally. Keeping a tally for each time you give a student a practice opportunity could be a quick gauge of your own skill. How many opportunities did you provide in today's session? How does that compare to yesterday's? You can also tackle this when lesson planning or examining your curriculum. How many high-quality components are built into the program already? How many opportunities will students have to respond when you give them this lesson? You can make notes or reminders for yourself ahead of time to build in more opportunities. Let's take a moment to reflect again. If you need a bit more time, pause the video to think about these questions. Reflection. Let's continue with our sample student, Tito. Imagine you want to collect data on whether you're providing enough engaging practice opportunities for Tito during your lesson. How would you go about checking on this? What makes sense in your classroom? Some possible solutions. Ask a peer to observe your next session and record what they see. Take a tally next session of each opportunity you provide. Here's a review of the data discussed so far. Now let's discuss behavioral data. Diagnostic data can enrich our understanding of a student's skills, the instruction we're providing, the roles of student behavior, and their environment. We also know that behavior is intricately linked with achievement. Students need to be motivated and engaged in order to access our instruction. Attention issues, lack of engagement, off-task behavior, or emotional dysregulation could all be areas that require more examination. If a student already has a behavior plan or had previously had a functional behavior assessment, circle back to those data sources for additional information if you haven't done so already. An FBA is a comprehensive and systematic observation to understand the purpose or function of a behavior. Knowing the function of a behavior allows us to create strategies or behavior plans that directly address the source of a behavior. Even without the formal procedures of an FBA, sometimes it can be helpful to carefully observe a student throughout instruction. What's happening just before or after their behaviors? You could ask a peer to observe for you or have them sub in while you observe the student. Additionally, depending on your student, it may be helpful to talk with them directly. Students can be very insightful. Lastly, a can't do, won't do activity helps you understand whether this is an issue where the student lacks the skill to participate or if they are choosing not to. The answer will lead to very different strategies on your part. If you're interviewing a student, make it conversational. Don't call it an interview. You're opening a dialogue to hear their perspective. Open the door with some lighter questions, like asking about their interests, which can also be helpful in building your relationship and finding sources of reinforcement for the future. Then you can pivot to questions about specific behaviors. Try to understand their frame of mind, how they perceive their circumstances, and their ideas for how you both can change the situation for the better. A can't-do, won't-do assessment disentangles skill needs from motivation needs. First, select the appropriate task. If a student seems to be unmotivated when reading passages, you can use ORF probes. Then, select a number of items that are highly motivating for this particular student. Remember, reinforcers are not inherently reinforcing. It all depends on the person. Some people love peanut butter cups and would run a mile for a bag. Others wouldn't even put their shoes on for one. Next, have the student do the task and record their score. Then, tell them they'll get a reward if they can beat their score and have the student do it again. If they beat their score, reward them as promised. However, for diagnostic purposes, just beating the score isn't a high enough threshold. If they improve their score by more than 20% when highly motivated, that suggests you may need to explore motivational supports for this behavior. If they can't improve their score significantly, they are likely performing at their ability level. We've looked at three of the four categories so far. Now let's discuss environmental data. Diagnostic data can enrich our understanding of a student's skills, the instruction we're providing, the roles of student behavior, and their environment. Relatedly, the environment can have a profound impact on how students learn. The other students in the group, as well as their skills, will influence both what you teach as well as the instructional interactions you have. The behavior of other students, as well as their dynamics amongst each other, may be worth considering. Lastly, consider how your classroom is managed. Have you taught, modeled, and retaught expected behaviors and routines? Predictability and reliability can be helpful for letting students focus on what matters. Gathering environmental data is similar to how we gather the other data we've talked about. Observing or talking to students is helpful here too. In addition, you can gather information about your group's skills and review existing data, such as how the groups are organized and their intervention plans. Here's our table of diagnostic data sources again, after discussing all four categories. Let's review the main points of the module. What data typically tell us when a student is not responding to instruction? CBM data are efficient and useful for telling us when a student is making progress or when they are not. What data can tell us why a student is not responding to instruction? Diagnostic data are where we can turn to better understand how to align our instruction with a student's needs. What are the four major sources of diagnostic data reviewed in this module? Skills, instruction, behavior, and environment are four sources of diagnostic data. Let's take a moment to reflect on our learning. If you need a bit more time, pause the video to think about these questions. Reflection: think of a student you're working with or have worked with who wasn't demonstrating progress. What diagnostic data would have helped you better understand how to serve them? How would you collect it? Let's revisit our guiding questions. What is the purpose of diagnostic assessment in reading? Develop a hypothesis about why current instruction is not meeting needs. Identify specific skills and abilities to target. Plan individualized intensive interventions for struggling students. When should diagnostic assessments be administered? When your progress monitoring data indicate your student is not making adequate progress. What types of diagnostic assessments are recommended? Academic, instructional, behavioral, and environmental data. Thank you for your time and engagement during this mini training module. Check out our Project Expert YouTube channel for other mini modules and resources to support database decision making in reading. Don't forget to like and subscribe. For questions about Project Expert, please contact the principal investigator, Dr. Jessica Tost, at the University of Texas at Austin. Dr. Tost's email is jrtoste@austin.utexas.edu. Project Expert is supported by a grant from the Institute of Educational Sciences, U.S. Department of Education.